Hi everyone and welcome to our session on Trading the Market Smarter. I'm Graham O'Brien, I'm from the ASX and I head up our cash equity sales and equity derivatives market for the exchange. I've been at the ASX for just over 20 years and I'm going to share some of my experience that I've had both in cash equity markets and in derivative markets as well in this particular session. We often get questions from new investors to the market around what our trading hours are for the share market itself. And then a lot of confusion around opening and closing auctions. So we'll start off by giving some good details of when you can trade in the share market in Australia and how our opening and closing auctions work. We'll also have a look at some important trading dates that you need to be aware of because they're often days where the market can move quite a lot or lots of volume going through on those particular days. We'll also have a look into some leading indicators. Are there ways that you can get information from us at the ASX or even from your brokers that might give you a little bit of a hint as to what the market thinks will be happening in the future? We'll also have a look at an option strategy that helps you to make your shares work harder and allow you to generate some extra incomes over and above dividends. And then finally, what you might want to do from a next steps perspective. So let's kick things off by looking at the equity market trading hours, so shares that are traded on the market itself. And there's a whole range of different phases that our market goes through, from pre-open, from 7 till 10 in the morning, to an opening phase, then to just normal trading, through to a pre-closing single price auction state, to then that closing single price auction. And we're going to just quickly step through those so you can understand what you can do and what you can't do depending on the time of the day when you're trading in the Australian share market. So between 7 and 10 a.m., and this is Sydney time that we're using here, during the pre-open, you can actually enter orders through to your brokers. However, your brokers, when they enter them into the ASX's trading system, it doesn't match against other orders in the marketplace. Effectively, you join the queue with other people in the market waiting for the market to open at 10 a.m. Once we get to that 10 a.m. phase, we don't open all the stocks in the market at the same time at the ASX. At 10 a.m., plus or minus 15 seconds, there's a randomizer that goes on in the equity market of when stocks will open. Any symbol or stock symbol that you see, if it starts with a 0 or a 9 or an A to a B, that's when those particular stocks open. 2 minutes and 15 seconds later, the next tranche or group come on to the marketplace itself. And that's stocks C to F. So a stock like CSL will open at any time between 10:02 and 10:02 and 30 seconds. Group 3, G to M, that's when those particular stocks open. And then so on and so forth until we get through to the final tranche, which is Group 5, that opens any time between 10:08, 45 seconds, and 10:09 and 15 seconds, which is S to Z. It just enables the market to concentrate on each individual sector of the marketplace while the market's opening. Once we get through those opening phases and all of those stocks are open, we then move into the normal trading, which many of you will be used to seeing in the marketplace itself. So from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m., normal trading occurs. When you place your order, all of those orders then trade at what we call price time priority. So whatever is at the best price that was entered first is the order that is executed first in the ASX markets. Once we get to 4 o'clock, that's when normal trading ends, but it doesn't mean that's the end of trading on the ASX trading day. Between 4 and 4:10 p.m., we have what is called the pre-closing single price auction. It's very similar to the way that the pre-open works before the market actually opens itself. For that 10-minute period, orders can be entered, but they're not matched in the trading engine itself. It's not until the closing single price auction occurs, which is any time between 4:10 and 4:11, that the closing prices for many stocks in our markets are determined. And that's where it can be a little bit confusing for the market, is how do these auctions work? Because we actually use auctions to open our market at 10 a.m. and we actually use auctions to close our market at 4:10 p.m. as well. But let's quickly touch on auctions themselves. And the reason that we use auctions at the ASX is really to provide you, as the investors, with the ability to trade with all other investors at a closing or an opening price. It really pulls liquidity into our markets, into our marketplaces. But for those of you that are wanting to understand how trading works around those auctions, it's important to understand the four-step approach that we use to determine what price the market will either open at if it was in those opening tranches, or where the market will close at if it's the closing tranches themselves or the closing single price option. So number one is price. That's the most important thing when it comes to our options. People will put in a whole bunch of buy orders, a whole bunch of sell orders, and when those orders overlap, so buyers paying up and sellers selling down, we look at the marketplace at ASX and we see where would it be, which price would the most volume go through at? And that's the very first step that we use. So there'll be lots of sellers overlapping all of these buyers. At what price could most volume go through at? That's our first step that we use in our analysis. If there's two prices at which the market would do that maximum volume, then when we then move to that next step, which is the minimum surplus volume. So how much will be left over on the order book? If obviously we had a whole bunch of orders being executed, what would be left over as a result of that auction on either the bid or the offer? Whatever is the lowest amount, that would be the second step. Once again, if there was still a couple of prices at that particular level, we look at, okay, if there was more buyers at that particular case, we'll use the higher of the two prices. If there was more sellers, we'll use the lower of those two prices. If all of that still doesn't determine what that auction price will be, we then use the last sale price as a reference, and whichever is the auction price that's closest to the last sale price we'll use. But the most important thing is wherever the most trading can go through at, whatever the most volume will go through at, that will be the price that is matched for both the open or the closing auction. Importantly, auctions also occur when stocks are coming new to our market, so IPO stocks, but then also when there's price-sensitive announcements and those stocks coming back onto the market, we'll use auctions again. But it's a really good way for investors to be able to trade with lots of other people all at the same price, because it pulls lots of liquidity in our market. There's also important trading dates that you need to be aware of when it comes to our cash equities market at ASX. One of the most important for investors, especially those self-managed super funds that like dividends and the franking credits that come with them, you need to be aware of dividends and ex-dividend dates, most importantly. Because once a stock moves to an ex-dividend status, it is no longer holding that dividend anymore. So you need to be looking for either a CD or an XD in the basis of quotations on your broker's screen. If the stock has a CD, it means that they've announced a dividend, but it's still come that dividend. So if you bought that particular share, you would still be receiving that particular dividend. However, if you were to sell a share, you want to be waiting until after the ex-dividend date. If you sell it when there's an XD code against the basis of quotation, it means you will still receive the dividend, but you're then able to go on and sell those shares. Just be mindful around those particular dates and those statuses when you're trading around dividend time. Also, derivatives expiry days lead to a lot of volume that goes through in our equities market at ASX. Futures expiry each quarter, and they're the third Thursday of each quarter, so March, June, September, and December. And where all the volume goes through at is that opening auction that we saw in a few slides ago. That is where not all stocks open at 10 a.m. To facilitate this very large amount of volume that goes throughout our market each quarter, that extension of 2 minutes 15 in between each group actually gets extended to 4 minutes in between each group. So that opening phase stretches out for longer in time around those dates. Importantly, options expiry will also have an impact on pricing around stocks, but when it's single stock options, it's still on that third Thursday, but it's the last price, so it's the closing single price option that will be affected by derivatives expiry. Another thing to keep in mind of when you're trading in equities markets, when there's lots of volume, potential for stocks to move, is when indices rebalance. So you might have heard of the S&P ASX 200 index. Stocks come in and out of that index generally on a quarterly basis, and the index is rebalanced. Fund managers adjust their holdings within their portfolios to match that index, often around that particular date. Another index provider in MSCI does lots of global indices, has a very large impact on especially our top 50 stocks And then one of the others is FTSE, also has an index that many fund managers benchmark to and will adjust their portfolios as a result. Often there's very large increase in trading on the close of market on those index rebalance dates. And if I give you a guide as to how high that can be, look at 29th of May 2020 was the highest ever closing single price auction that we had on the ASX. $8 billion worth of shares transferred hands on the 29th of May last year. Even this year, on the 17th of September, so only a couple of months ago, we saw $7.85 billion go through in that closing single price auction. All of our top 10 closing auctions at ASX all align with index rebalance dates. And to give you a guide as to how much activity goes on there, on those particular days, it's approximately 45% of the entire trading day's volume actually goes through on those closing auctions themselves. So lots and lots of volume going through the market. I touched on the derivatives expiry and the note that especially for futures, it's on the open. The largest opens that we've had on the ASX are all aligned to those futures expiry days themselves. Not quite as much volume when you compare it over to the entire day as an index rebalance, but still almost a fifth of all, just over a fifth actually, of all activity that you see on those days actually happens on the open itself. So just be mindful of what can happen in those particular markets around particular days in the marketplace itself. I mentioned the idea of leading indicators. So we've looked at obviously how markets open, what are our trading hours, days to watch out for. There's actually some leading indicators that you can get from statistics that the ASX release each and every month. I've provided actually a link on the slides for you to go to. If you go to the ASX website, you can go to the derivatives statistics section, and there's elements within it that gives us a leading indicator of what the market might be thinking will be happening over the next 3 months. Two of these indicators are called put call indicators or long short analysis. And what they're looking at is options trading activity, whether the options market is net long or net short, puts or calls in the market. Generally in the options market, activity happens within the next 3 months, so it gives you a nice 90-day outlook. Those two charts that you see on the right-hand side of your screen give you an indication of what the market might be expecting. If we go back to March 2020, you can see that big dip in the line chart, which is the S&P ASX 200 index, in a spike in those column charts that we can see. That was the options market all of a sudden going long a whole bunch of put options before we saw the big correction that occurred in the market around March 2020. And we all know how big that correction was in the market. Similarly, the put call indicator chart below that gives us an indication of whether the market is net trading puts, which thinks the market's going down, versus net trading calls, thinking the market will go up. Whenever the index or the put call indicator is below 100, it means more calls are being traded than puts. Whenever it's above 100%, it means more puts being traded than calls. But it gives you some style of an indication as what the market might be thinking over the next 3 months or so. And to close off on our little session around trading the market smarter, I think it's important to use a trading strategy anyway that lots and lots of people are using in the market. And we move to the options market for that. An opportunity to be able to make our shares work harder. Through selling call options, people can enhance their returns on their investments, preset sale price for shares, and provide limited downside protection. It really is ideal for stocks that you think will be range bound and trying to enhance income over and above dividends. But as with all trading style strategies, there's only certain market environments that actually this strategy works for. You want to be neutral to moderately bullish on the market. Don't think the market's going to rally significantly, this strategy is not going to work for you. If you think there's a big correction on the way, this strategy is not going to work for you. It's sideways moving markets that you might want to consider making your shares work harder through selling call options. Selling a call option obligates you to do something in the future. And it obligates you to sell shares at some date in the future for an agreed upon price. And that is what we call the strike price. Let's say you've got a stock that's trading at $20. You might be happy to sell those shares when it gets to $22. So you can go and sell a $22 call option which will obligate you to sell those shares if it goes above $22. There's time frames at which you'll be obligated for, and they're the expiration dates. Always keep it within 3 months when you're trading this style of a strategy. And for that, you receive a premium. You receive an income stream from the options market itself. So let's use a quick fictitious example. Let's say you hold 1,000 XYZ shares at $4.60, and our outlook is neutrally to moderately bullish on that particular underlying. So we go to the options market. Now we look for a 3 month or within 3 months till expiry. So we look for a February expiring option. Options are 100 shares per contract. So we can sell 10 options for the 1,000 shares we hold. And let's say we would be comfortable with the market rallying 30 cents. So from $4.60 to $4.90. So we sell a $4.90 call and receive 14 cents per share from the options market. We're long those shares at $4.60. We sell 10 $4.90 calls at 14 cents. What does it do to our portfolio? We originally held shares at $4.60. Because you receive 14 cents in income for every share that you hold, you effectively reduce your break even on those shares now to $4.46. You can actually have those shares full a little bit before you'll be making a loss now. However, if the stock rallies above $4.90, the strike price of our option, we'll have to sell our shares, and however, we will get to keep our premium that we actually originally received. So it's going to cap our maximum profit with this strategy. 44 cents is the most that we can make on XYZ shares, no matter how high they go, whilst we have this strategy implemented. Hence, don't do it on stocks so you're going to think going to the moon. So if the stock goes up in value, options will be assigned. We'll have to sell those shares at $4.90, keep the 14 cents in premium, and we'll also get to keep the 30 cents in capital appreciation on those shares. If the shares just rallied to $4.90, probably a perfect spot. Keep the premium, also keep the 30 cents in premium. However, if the stock falls in value, if it falls below $4.46, we only received 14 cents in income, so we're only protected down to that $4.46 mark. If that particular stock fell below those levels, then you'll be net losing on the overall strategy. Really good way for people to generate income streams. We looked at this as a 3 month strategy. If you did it four times during the year, you can get upwards of 40 cents in premium from the options market, over 9% in options premium that you'd be receiving over and above dividends. A really good way to generate income streams. And it does give us that little bit of a partial hedge, but there's always risks to every trade, isn't there? Capture upside, and there's obviously downside risk if the stock falls significantly. So once again, only hold things that you want to hold within your portfolio. Thanks for that quick summary of looking at cash equity markets and a very brief summary of the most popular of our option strategies. I think you're probably going to need some more information when it comes to either trading in shares or trading in options markets. Best place is the ASX website. For further education, just go to the general ASX investment tools and resources section, which will give you a whole host of online courses, give you access to share market games, even give you access to broker research. And when it comes to the options market, you can do online courses. You can read a whole bunch about different trading strategies in the options market. We provided the link there as well. If you actually want to test out some trading strategies, best way is via our games at ASX. Either go to the ASX share market game when it comes to equity or share trading, or the options game when it comes to trading and options. Thank you for your time for looking at this particular video. Please reach out to us if you have any more questions at info@asx.com.au. Thank you again.